Welcome to Module 2 of the City and County Solar PV Training Program. My name is Emma Elkvist, and I'll be your host for today. The topic of this module is Screening and Identifying PV Projects, and today we'll talk about the different drivers of PV project potential and how you can assess your site using energy modeling tools that incorporate these drivers. Once you've completed this module, you'll be able to understand the different factors that impact the technical and economic potential of a PV project, the steps of the PV screening process, and how to use REOP Light to screen your site for PV and storage project potential. Once you've set your energy goals and formed a strong project team, it's time to screen sites to identify potential projects. The purpose of the screening is to quickly and efficiently down-select to viable technologies and sites. This reduces potential costly investment of time and money in unlikely projects. A screening provides an initial indicator of technical and economic viability in initial go, no-go decisions. Let's start by talking about the drivers of PV potential that determines if PV will work for your site. There are many factors that determine if PV will work for your site. This includes your solar resource or how much energy a solar project will produce given your location, the cost of solar technologies and applicable incentives, or how much you'll be paying for the project, the space that you have available, or how large of a project you'll be able to consider, your utility cost and consumption, or what the solar project will be offsetting, and finally, the financial parameters, which determine the cost effectiveness. Each of these factors needs to be considered when evaluating PV at your site, and I'll be going into more detail about each of them in the next few slides. One of the factors determining if PV is a good fit for your location is the magnitude of the solar resource. Resource maps, like the one shown here, give you a high-level picture of how the solar resource varies throughout the United States. You can see that the highest solar resource is in the Southwest, while the Pacific Northwest has the lowest solar resource. However, compared to other renewable energy resources, the solar resource only varies by a factor of less than 2. As a result, solar projects are being implemented across all 50 states. The NSRDB data viewer, shown here, allows users to explore the solar resource across the US and other countries in a general region or at a specific location. The zoom feature allows users to get a more granular view of their solar resource than a static map would typically provide. Note the link to the NSRDB viewer at the bottom of the slide. This link, along with other resources, are provided in a separate document that you can access after you've completed this module. Another great source for estimating the solar resource at a particular location is a tool called PV Watts. With just a few simple inputs, including the site's location and system configuration, the user can get a sense of both the annual and hourly energy generation of a potential PV system. Another important driver of PV project potential is the cost of the technology itself. It's important to consider the total installed cost, which includes not only the PV module, but also the inverter and other hardware components, as well as soft costs such as labor, taxes, and overhead. This chart shows the total cost declines in residential, commercial, and utility-scale PV costs over the past 8 years. In general, larger systems are cheaper on a per-kilowatt basis. These are US average costs, but PV costs can also vary by geographic location and installer. Incentives can help lower the total cost of a PV system. Common incentives include capacity incentives, which are based on the total installed size of the PV system, production incentives, which are based on how much electricity the system is generating, and net metering incentives, which gives you bill credit, even if the PV production exceeds your load at a particular time. This map shows the 38 US states and territories that have some form of net metering incentives. The database of state incentives for renewables and efficiency, or DESIRE, is a great resource for staying up to date with incentives in your area. You'll also need to know how much space is available for a PV project. A PV system is typically roof-mounted, ground-mounted, or installed as part of a carport. Shown here is a site interested in PV that has identified the carport area in pink, roof area in blue, and ground area in green. Where you install the PV system impacts the density or how many panels you can fit in a given area. The cost of the system: ground-mounted systems are typically the cheapest, while carport systems are typically the most expensive. The tilt and orientation of the system, and the viewshed of your site. Project Sunroof is a tool that can be used to estimate how much PV fits on your roof. Just type in your address, and you'll get a snapshot of the area available for PV and whether or not that area is shaded. Your current utility cost is perhaps one of the most important factors in deciding if PV is going to work at your site. Compared to the PV resource, which varies by a factor of 2 across the United States, utility costs can vary by a factor of up to 10. But it's not as simple as just dollars per kilowatt hours. There can be many components and different types of charges on your electricity bill, and installing PV impacts those charges differently. The energy charges are determined by the amount of electricity that a site consumes. PV can reduce the amount of electricity purchased and therefore this charge. Just be aware that the energy charge can vary depending on the season and time of day. Another common component is demand charges. This is billed not on the total electricity consumption, but on the highest amount, typically per month. PV can help reduce demand costs if the PV production coincides with peak demand. Finally, fixed charges are common components of electricity bills, but PV cannot offset these. The map on the left shows the maximum demand charge for each U.S. utility territory. These can vary from $0 per kilowatt to over $30 per kilowatt. You can find information about your utility cost and structure on your bill, but also through the utility rate database, which lists the rate structure and costs for over 47,000 U.S. utility rates. We're now going to look at an example of how PV and storage can be used to offset energy and demand charges. Shown in black on this graph is the site's electrical load for 1 week. The electricity use increases during the day and decreases at night. The area under this curve is the total electricity consumption. The electricity purchased from the grid is shown in gray. The PV system in orange is offsetting some of this electricity during the day when the sun is shining. By doing so, it's offsetting energy charges on the utility bill. The demand charge is determined not by the area underneath the curve, but by its maximum height. As you can see in this example, the PV system is not generating electricity at the time of the maximum demand, and therefore not offsetting demand charges. Unlike PV, storage can be dispatched in the evenings when the sun is no longer shining. By doing so, it can be used to mitigate demand charges. In this example, by adding a small storage system, shown here in blue, the site's able to reduce its demand charges. Finally, financial parameters impact the long-term cost-effectiveness of PV. The inflation rate impacts future O&M costs. The utility cost escalation rate impacts the future cost of energy that the PV system is offsetting. And the discount rate impacts the financing cost of the project. The chart here shows the impact that the utility cost escalation rate can have. A site's rate of 6 cents per kilowatt hour today is projected to increase to somewhere between 9 and 15 cents per kilowatt hour over the next 25 years, depending on the utility cost escalation rate used. EIA is a good resource for utility cost escalation rate information. We're now going to go over the general PV screening process. You would first start by defining the goals of the analysis. As you learned in Module 1, there are many nuances to renewable energy goals, and these can impact your analysis. Next, you would collect and review your site data. This can be somewhat time-consuming, so keep in mind that you can start with readily available data and only obtain more detailed data if the project appears feasible. You would then run the analysis. This is an iterative process where you adjust the data and run additional analysis to refine your results. Finally, you can use this information to identify sites for more in-depth assessment. To recap, the purpose of a screening is to quickly and efficiently down-select to viable technologies and sites, and to reduce potential costly investment of time and money in unlikely projects. An initial screening provides go, no-go decisions and indicators of technical and economic viability. An initial screening doesn't provide final answers or investment-grade audit results. PV modeling and analysis tools can help evaluate your site's potential. They are comprehensive in that they take into account all the factors that we've talked about today. Listed here are 4 tools that can be used to gauge initial potential, optimize system sizing, and refine project economics. They vary in the expertise needed, inputs required, and key outputs provided. Today we're going to take a closer look at ReUpLite, a free-to-use web tool that was recently released by NREL.